you make me brave. Can you believe the conference was last week? Oh my goodness. It was only a week ago. But good morning, everybody. Welcome to the house of our God. Those of you who are able to be a part of that conference, what a wonderful time we had. What a wonderful time. You know, all the musicians, it's like, where are they, right? Where'd they all go? Get them back here, man. Who said they can go? But praise the Lord, they'll be back next year. But anyway, it's good to have you all in the house of God. You know, as I look around the room, I'm always impressed how God works in our lives where he causes us to impact each other in such a great way. Have you ever noticed the impact that one person can have upon another person? Yes. You know, amen. You know, Mario, we haven't seen you in a while, so it's so good to have you back in the house, brother, really. Yeah, amen. Why not? Amen. Yeah. We missed you, and we've been asking about you, so to have you back here, you are a blessing, brother. It's good to have you back in the house. And let's see, who do we got back there? Where's Brother Keith? I see you, Arlene. Where's Brother Keith at? Oh, there's Keith over there. Okay, and Arlene, introduce us to your husband. Yeah, tell us his name. Uh-huh. All right. Sure. Mm-hmm. Glad you're here. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. You know, you bless us. Keith, you bless us. Arlene and Richard, you bless us. Thank you for being here. Yes. Amen. Amen. And all of you. Felisa and Larry, my goodness, you've been away way too long. How was your time away? Did you have a good time? We missed you. We missed you. We're glad you're back. Amen. So welcome back to the house. Praise the Lord, everybody. Chef Jack, we welcome you back after your time away. But amen, Chef Jack. God bless you, sir. We had to have some fill-ins for you last week. You know that, right? It took two guys to take your place. It's just so you know. But our prayers are with you as you continue on the new journey that God's put before you. So God bless you all. Amen. God bless you. You know, if you look into your bulletins, I'd like for you to look into your bulletins and see the title of our conversation. The title of our conversation, if you can read it from your bulletin there, the title of our conversation is God Conscious. God Conscious. You know, there are several passages in the Bible that calls us to be God conscious. You can be conscious in so many areas, but we're called to be God conscious as the people of God. And when you look at that word, you know, the definition of conscious is really a very simple definition. The word conscious means to be aware of. You know, so if you are God conscious, you are aware of God. It means to be awake to. Awake to the things of God. Amen. This is the word conscious. So it means to be awake to. And even as we walk in the doors this morning, sometimes I wonder, you know, some mornings we have more energy than other mornings. But I say, you know, are we awake this morning? You know, did anybody wake up this morning? Of course you did. My question is, what did you wake up to this morning? Or not even just this morning, what do you generally wake up to? And, you know, you can answer to yourselves or maybe just think about that. Some of you wake up and the first thing that's on your mind is, I don't know, could be many things. What'd you say, coffee? Uh-huh. So you are coffee conscious. Okay, good, good. Coffee conscious is good. Some of you think about your family, right? Some of you think about your loved ones, the first thing you think about. Some of you think about work. Some of you go to bed with work and you sleep work and you wake up work, you know. You know, some of you wake up to, I don't know, the concerns of life perhaps, you know. Maybe on a Sunday you don't. Maybe on a Sunday is one of those rare days where you wake up with a God conscious, you know, where you wake up thinking about God. And that's the best conscious of all. It's to be God conscious. You know, what do you wake up to? And you know, really throughout most of the days, the question would be in regard to our conversation, what are you conscious of most of the time? You know, what are you conscious of? What occupies most of your thoughts? And you know, it's interesting because I know Sunday is a great day because it causes us to focus ourselves back upon God again and maybe revisit what life is all about. Amen, Brother Keith. Sometimes it's good to break up the monotony of the week and we get reminded that we serve a great God. And that life is so much more than we get tied up with during the week. But what are you conscious of during the week? Because if we're honest with each other, I would have to say that we're not really conscious of the life of God during the week. I think it's okay, part of our human nature, we're more conscious of what we do all day long, which is, you know, some of us work or whatever it might be. We got these thoughts continually in our head. You know, it seems as if, you know, we live our lives just to pay the bills and get things done and just take care of business. And God bless those of you who do. But the Lord Jesus Christ, when he came to the earth, he spoke to you like he spoke to the others. And he would say the same thing to you that he said 2,000 years ago. He would come to the earth if he came into a physical form as he did before. And he would say, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And if we heard those words from our God, yeah, that's exactly what we'd say, Brother Nick. We'd say, thank you, Lord Jesus. And even just hearing those words, sometimes it breaks our train of thought. You know, like, oh, man, I forgot about God. Anybody? Oh, I was so tied down with this small issue. And someone mentioned God, and all of a sudden, my issue is not so big anymore. My problem is not so weighty anymore. You know, Jesus Christ came to the earth, and he said those words. He said, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Because it seems as if we're conscious of so many things. So many things. And the Lord, I love him. Don't you love him? Yeah. Man, he makes your mind lighter, if you will. Your days lighter. He removes your burdens from you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. I'm going to ask you another question as we go forward. Have you ever heard the phrase, you become what you worship? By a show of hands, have you ever heard that phrase? Not that many, really? You just don't want to raise your hands. You become what you worship. Now, that's a truth. It's a scriptural truth, but it's also a life truth. You become what you worship. And the word worship is not necessarily associated with religion. The word worship is really associated with what you do on a regular basis, what you do with most of your time. The word worship means, what do you give value to? And what you give value to, really, it's not the empty words. Your life will show what you give value to, because what you give value to is what you give your time to. It's what you give your time to, what you give your thoughts to. You ever hear yourself say or hear somebody say, I didn't have time to do that? Truth of the matter is, we all have the same amount of time. It's just that that item took less value of the other things that you gave your time to. Can I get an honest witness from anyone in the house? Whatever that may be, I don't know what it is in your life that you say you don't have time to do. You can answer, you don't have to answer. Whatever it is you say you don't have time for, it's because there isn't a great value attached to it. Because what you value, you will give your time to. When I want to do something, and when you want to do something, believe me, I do it. Sometimes it's the first thing you do in the morning. If you want to do it, you'll do it. It's interesting. It's the things we don't want to do, all of a sudden we think, oh, I'm just too busy. I don't have time. All right, maybe. See, what do you worship? What do you worship? I'm not going to ask you by your words. I'm going to ask you by your actions. You worship what you give your time to. You worship, even added to that, what you give your thoughts to. What you give your thoughts to is what you worship. What do you think about all day? And apply to our message today, are we thinking about the greatness and the goodness of God? Or are we thinking about what we have to get done? Are we thinking about our bills, our concerns, our worries? What do you think about most of the day, all day, aside from a Sunday? I'm not asking for an answer, but you just give it some thought. Because what you think about most of the time, that's what you worship. And you will become what you worship. Interesting. Do you find it interesting? Anybody in the house? Worship isn't coming to church singing three songs or sitting down, listening to San Jerome give us an announcement or two, put up with the preacher for 20 minutes and go home. How dare you call my religion? You just knocked down my whole faith. I worship today. Barely. If you call that worship, you barely worship today. Yeah, I want to know what you're really thinking about Monday to Friday, yeah. Because that's what you worship. And always know this, God is never here to smack our wrists. He's here, never. God is always here to encourage us. Amen, Sister Felisa. To set us free. Because the moment that God enters a room, it breaks everything else, right? He just wants to enter the room and break your thoughts. Once you have a God-conscious thought, it breaks the power of all those other things that were draining your life from you. Can I get a witness? Whew, and that's when we say, thank you, Jesus. I forgot about you. I forgot about God. Huh. You become what you worship, and what you worship is what it's what you value. It's what you give your time to, your thought to. It's what you give your energy to. It's what you give your pursuits to. What is your pursuit? That's really what you worship. And the call of God is to us, once again, is be God conscious. And some of you might say, if you're honest with me, you guys out there, who said, I'll talk to you. The brother Mark, me and you, brother. I didn't even get a yes from anybody. I got a But Mark, I bless you for it. That's funny. It's so funny, I forgot what I was talking about. Be God conscious. All right. If you have your Bibles, let's turn to a verse. Turn to 1 Peter. It's our text for today. 1 Peter chapter 2. Yeah. Let's read two verses there. Let's read verses 18 and 19. This is interesting. Let's see where God's taking us. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 through 19. Let me read it to you if you don't have a Bible today. It says, servants. And everybody's a servant and everybody's a master. It depends upon who you're with and where you're with and what time of the day it is. But servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear. For this is interesting. For not only to the good and the gentle, but also to the harsh. It says be submissive to those things that have charge of your life, whether they're pleasant things or not pleasant things. I could talk about that, but that's not really where we're going. Verse 19 says this, for it is commendable. It is commendable if because of conscience toward God, if you are aware of God, if you are aware of God in your life, that one endures grief and suffering wrongly. If you are conscious towards God, you will endure grief and suffering. But my question is this. Everybody in life experiences some kind of grief and some kind of suffering and some kind of wrong. But what is your thoughts towards? Where is your consciousness? Are you thinking about God or are our thoughts on our grief and our suffering and our sorrow? Because the truth is, everybody in this house has some kind of trial. And if it's not a trial, some kind of fiery trial in their life. Is anybody out there? Give me You see, everybody has some kind of suffering, sorrow, grief, or wrongdoing in their life. But what are your thoughts towards? Are you God conscious or are you conscious towards those things? Are you thinking about your suffering? Are you thinking about your grief? Are you thinking about your loss? How do you know? Well, you're talking about it. If you're thinking about it, you're talking about it, right? So what are you conscious of all day, every day? What is your thoughts and what is your life? What do you worship? What do you worship? And the truth of the matter is, it's okay, God's taking us somewhere. What we spend most of our time is not towards God. Most of the time is not towards praising God. We might tack him on at the end of it all, but hallelujah anyhow, something like that. Anyone ever do a hallelujah anyhow after you just talked about an hour about your sorrow? Man, no one wants to talk to me today. John, will you talk to me? Sister Joy, we are supposed to be the people of God. That doesn't mean you tack on God to the end of your conversation. It means he is your conversation. Come on now. Are we the people of God? Are we God conscious? Or is God just a disclaimer or a beginning or the end of our sentences? Because really, it's okay. I'm constantly reminding myself and each other, God just wants to help us. He just wants to bless us. He's not looking to smack us on the wrist. He's looking to save us. He wants to interrupt your thought pattern. He wants to interrupt your light with a God thought, man. We're all involved with all of everything going on, and all of a sudden, God. And like, man, it breaks it, man. When God has entered the room, entered your thoughts, entered your voice, everything is broken from it. Anybody. Yeah. God, man, he wants to save you. You think he wants to save the world? He's going to save the world through you. He's got to save you first. You first. I kind of like you first, me first. I kind of like that. He loves you first. I know he loves the world, but he loves you first. Come on. He wants to save you first. and you can take us outside these walls and we sound like everybody else. Are you recording that silence, Keith? We're talking about our husbands, our wives, our children, our teachers, our doctors, our sicknesses, our poverty, our aches, our pains, but God. Hallelujah, anyhow. Well, it's a start. I'll give you that. God says, you will become what you worship. The more you talk about it, the more that's your identity. The more you talk about all your pains, your woes, your sorrows, that becomes your identity. You become what you worship. That's your identity. That's who you are. It's who you are. Superficially, it's not really who you are. Right? Oh, my goodness. And Jesus really wants to save us, man. He really wants to set us free. So he says this. He says, quite honestly, God never says, as we said on Wednesday and the Sunday before, God is not going to take the woe out of your life. He's not taking the sorrow out of your life. He's not taking the wrongdoing out of your life. He says, what good is it if you suffer when you did something wrong? Who cares? You're supposed to suffer when you do something wrong, for crying out loud. It says, what? How about if you do it, if you suffer for doing everything right? See, that's the gospel. We don't even know what the gospel is. We think the gospel is, how dare you talk to me like that? I'm a Christian. No, that's not the gospel. The gospel is when somebody curses you when you don't deserve a curse. When somebody does something wrong to you and you did nothing to deserve it. And then you say, there's nothing but God in your mouth. Well, God's in here somewhere. How can I bless this person? How can I help this person? Instead of us trying to right the wrongs, especially the ones that have been done to us in life. Man, we want to right all the wrongs that's been done to us. We'll call 1,000 people. We'll get our money back. We'll get our respect back. How about just get God? Let somebody else have your money and your respect. I don't think so, preacher, but you could keep going anyway. Keep preaching like that, I'll tell you. Something, isn't it? I mean, it's something. It really is. So this is what it's saying. You know, what are you conscious of in your life? Are you conscious of your grief and your sorrow and your suffering? You know, we don't have to go on anymore. We can pretty much stay here and ask God to have this work in our lives. We can ask God, have this work in my life, Lord Jesus. Let me stop being aware of everything that's missing in my life and everything that's broken and hurtful in my life. Let me be God conscious. We say we're God conscious, but really only with our lips, right? Who said right? See, God conscious means he's in our lips also. Let's go on. All right, so you know, I guess the follow-up question would be this. You know, never mind your own life. Because, you know, we struggle there. But even the greatest struggle, I think, is, you know, what about the people and the world around you? What's your awareness in regard to the people around you? And what's your awareness of the world that you live in? You know, are you God conscious or otherwise conscious, you know? Because you will become what you worship. If your thoughts are towards an evil and corrupt world, well, then you'll continually live in an evil, corrupt world. Anybody? So what are your thoughts? And I ask the same question, and may we all be transformed by this. What are your thoughts about the people around you? Are you God conscious about the people around you? Do you see God in everybody around you? Or do you see fault in people around you? I got an honest chuckle over there. You know what? Are you God conscious? And let God ask us this question. Are we God conscious? And then, you know, how about this question? In regard to the world that we live in, are we God conscious in regard to the world we live in? When you look at the world that you live in today, do you see God or something else? Because it can only be God. It can only be God. Because you'll become what you worship. You know, and you can see the wrong and the suffering and the wrongdoing, as Peter said. But Peter admonished us to say, why don't you be God conscious instead? Because you will become what you worship. Your identity will be created by what you worship. And if we constantly are conscious of an evil world and a corrupt, broken world, then that becomes our identity. We're a person who's a victim living in an evil, corrupt world, and we're subjected to all of the corruptions of this world then. And that's why I'm sorry, and that's why I'm broken, and that's why I'm ripped off, and that's why I'm depressed, and that's why I'm sick. Anybody in the house? See, what God's going to do, he's going to change your minds, man. And he tells you the answer is to be God conscious. Because if you can look into the world, you have to see the biggest thing that exists in the world. It's God. It's God. When you look into your life, you could see a couple of broken things, but the biggest thing in your life is the goodness of God. It's the love of God. It's the forgiveness of God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But this consciousness does not only apply to you, it applies to how you see people and how you see the world. And the Lord says he wants us to be God conscious when we look into the world that we live in and we look into the people's lives all around us. The answer is maybe this can set us free, or maybe this can just change our mind. You can see God. As a matter of fact, God tells you to. And the more you see him, the more you'll talk about him. You'll stop talking about all of the brokenness of your life, how bad everybody is around you, and how bad this world lives in. And if you notice, if you go back your whole life long, you've always talked about that, and that's always been who you are. Now you really don't like me. But God's going to change you. Why? Why? Because he loves you. Yeah, and if you have your Bibles, let me read another verse to you. Why don't you turn to Romans 12, and I say, Lord, go ahead and change our minds. Let us realize that salvation's all around us, not corruption. Corruption ain't all around you. Salvation is. Somebody pick up the ball and run with it, man. Salvation's there. Who wants it? Who wants it? One amen. Okay, Sandra. You guys are hurting me today, man. Hurting me. Hurting me today, man. You got Romans 12? No, I didn't bring my Bible, preacher. That's fine. I'll read to you. This is a well-known passage. As soon as I start talking about it, you'll know it. It talks about living sacrifices. Living sacrifices to God. It says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Have you ever heard that before? Yes. What does it say? Present what? Present your what? Present your bodies as a living sacrifice. How are you supposed to present yourself to God? Holy and acceptable. You're supposed to present your bodies to God holy and acceptable. Not only supposed to, you're allowed to. You're allowed to. You have been permitted to present yourself to God holy and acceptable, not based upon anything that you do, but based upon his wonderful love and mercies. Because it doesn't say that in the beginning, based upon the mercies of God. It says, brethren, by the mercies of God, listen, everybody, come on now. By the mercies of God, you can present yourself to God holy and acceptable. There's no other way you can. You can't present yourself holy and acceptable based upon your actions or the things that you say and the things that you do. Thank God, because then every one of us would be disqualified. Can I get an amen, please, somebody? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We can present ourselves to God holy today and acceptable, not only today, but every day, based upon his mercy. Yeah, amen, Brother Mario, amen. And it goes on, and it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind. God wants to change the way you think. He wants to change your thoughts. He wants to change your consciousness. What are you conscious of? He says, be renewed by the transforming of your mind. It says that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Huh. You guys have come across this theological question, right? What is the good, the perfect, and acceptable will of God? Well, let's dissect it. There's a good will. There's a perfect will. I don't know. But you see, we've all asked this question before. What is the good, the perfect, and acceptable will of God? Well, it says it in the verse prior, that you present yourself to God holy and acceptable. That's what God wants you to do. You want to make God happy? Present yourself to him as holy based upon his mercies. But look at the next verse again. Well, let's go to verse 4, rather. It says, For as we have many members in one body, so all the members do not have the same function. So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. So what body is it talking about in verse 1? It's talking about not my body, it's talking about us as a body, right? Who is the us? I pray that God can expand that us as much as you can take it, because the us is the world, I'll tell you. God always is about the world. He's not talking about the chosen frozen. God's always talking about the world. For God so loved the world. And God says this. God says, if you want to know what's holy and acceptable to him, he says, present your bodies holy to God. Who is the body? Everybody who lives and breathes. Amen. It's a many-membered body. Can you present the body holy to God? Because if you're God conscious, you can. Can you present the world holy to God? Yes. See, the truth of the matter is Jesus can and does, because he is forever making intercession for the world to the Father, because he knows the price that's already been paid. We don't understand the price that's been paid yet. And because we don't understand the price that has been paid yet, we still cannot present the world to God as holy. We do something else. We go and we pray to God. We say, that person is wicked. That person did this and that person did that. And Father, save me from this evil world that I live in. And does anybody ever pray prayers like that? Maybe not those exact words, but something like that. Can I get a mm-hmm? Mm-hmm. Thank you, Sister Hazel. So we wonder, when is God going to save the world? The truth of the matter is, he'll save the world as soon as he changes your mind. Amen. As soon as you stop presenting the world other than God, with a God-conscious mind, if you will present the body to him as holy, if you will present the world to him as holy, you cannot see the world as evil. If you see the world as evil, you are not God-conscious. You are otherwise conscious. Is there anybody here? Amen. Because sometimes we can take the word and apply it to us, but we have difficulty applying it to this guy that's in this next to me, and I could give you a whole list of things. Or the evils that we see in this world because we can't see God in the midst of them. And God says, you can look at the wrong in this world. You can look at the grief and the sorrow in this world. Or, Peter says, why don't you be God conscious? Why don't you see God in the world? Huh. And God says this, you want to know what's pleasing to God? Thank you, Lord Jesus. He says what's pleasing to him is if you will present people to him as holy, not as unholy. Amen. That's pleasing to the Father. Yes, well, you are not accuser of the brethren, but an advocate. And sometimes we take on the role of the accuser. You know why? Because we don't know who God is. Right. So I'll go before God and I'll accuse everybody because I don't know I'm supposed to be the advocate. And the one making intercession. And I don't know I'm supposed to be as Moses was. When God was really just testing Moses, God says, Moses, I'm going to destroy them all. And Moses says, don't destroy them. They're good. I know they're good. Give them another chance. Who are you? Who are you? Are you the Moses that says, Lord Jesus, my neighbor, the one across the globe, the world, there's good, there's God, there's holiness. Lord Jesus, give us your blessing. Or are we so worried about the wrong that's been done us, about the sorrow that's in our life, about the grief that people give us? He says, where's your God consciousness? What about me that's in your life? Anybody in the house? Amen. And God, I know what God wants to do. I know what God wants to do. He wants to change the way we think and change how we see the world and how we see ourselves. You will become what you worship. You will become what you worship. If you constantly see the evil in the world, all you're going to see is evil in your life. If you constantly see the sufferings in this world, you'll never get the sufferings out of your own life because you'll become what you worship. What you spend your time thinking about and looking at and talking about it is what you become. Yes. And that's why God tells you, and his love tells you, to be God conscious. If you will look into the world, if you look into people's eyes and their lives and the world itself and say how beautiful it is, can anybody say that? Yes. Can anybody say that Monday to Friday or just on a Sunday afternoon? Can you say that when everybody does you wrong? Can you still say that? Can anybody say that when everybody does you wrong? See, the truth of the matter is our souls, we're so fickle and fragmented. We're up, we're down, we're all around. We don't know nothing. You think you know something, you don't know nothing. That's why God is the constant in our life. You know, when your closest friend, the closest one to your heart betrays you, can you still say, God, you are beautiful and this person that betrayed me is beautiful? Can you do that? You know the answer is yes, because of the God that's inside you. Amen. Can you still say the world is beautiful when you can't pay any of your bills and you can't seem to get ahead in life and we're tempted to say, I don't like my life? I'll say it mildly. Or should we still be saying, the world is beautiful? Do you still on a Monday to Friday say, my life is beautiful? I love life. Because you will become what you worship. See, God's salvation is all around you and I. See, God is not taking all these things out of your life. He's causing you to see them differently, right? We're waiting for God to pay all our bills and put us in a mansion and make us healthy and strong. What kind of gospel is that? Who perpetuates that gospel, man? You see, you will become what you worship. And then let me just read one or two more verses. You know, in Psalm 115, it talks about, you know, what we worship. And I pray that God changes all forever. You know, Psalm 115, it says this. It says, not to us, O Lord, not to us. Life ain't all about us. It's not about us, Lord, but to you, O Lord. To you, O Lord. Not to us, but to your name be glory, Lord. Come on, help me out a little bit. Amen. I'll take that amen. Not to us, but to your name be glory, O Lord. Because of your love and your faithfulness. Now, these are the words that come out of your mouth when you wake up in the morning. Not to us, O God, but to you, O Lord, because of your love and your faithfulness. It says, why do the nations say, where is their God? Why should anyone ever say, where is your God? They should be running to your God. Are they running to your God, or they say, your God's no more bigger than their God, because you've got the same miserable conversation in your mouth. I shouldn't be talking like this, but but it says, why do the nations say, where is their God? Huh. Our God is in heaven, and he does what pleases him. But their idols are silver and gold. They're made by hands of men. They have mouths, but they cannot speak. Eyes, but they cannot see. They have ears, but they cannot hear. Noses, but they cannot smell. These are these other idols that we worship. They have hands, but they cannot feel. Nothing like our God. Feet, but they cannot walk. See, the truth of the matter is, these gods that you think are so powerful in your life, they have no power. These gods in your life and my life that want to take away the God out of my mouth and the God out of my mind, that wants to take my joy and my peace that I think are so strong, that I think are stronger than my God that has given me life and peace and truth and joy, I think these gods are so powerful that they're able to snatch the life of God from me, that they may want to make me despair of life itself. God says, these gods are no gods at all. These gods. He says, they have mouths they can't even speak, eyes they can't see. They got no power. Anybody in the house, they got no strength in your life. These things, they say they have a right to take your joy for today. They say, I'm taking your joy. And you say, why? Because you don't have any money today. That's good enough. Okay, I'll be sad today then. Because I can't pay my bills. I'm going to be sad today. What God is that? They got eyes, they got ears, they got no power. What are the gods in your life that are lying to you? I got this ache in my body. That's enough. I'm going to be sad today. I got this person that did me wrong today. I'm going to be unforgiving. I'm going to be bitter. I'm going to cry today. What's wrong with that, preacher? You see, these are the gods that are in your life and my life, and they think they're such powerful gods. Who is more powerful than your God? Does anybody have a God in this house? Come on now. Does anybody have a real God? A real God. A God that came to this earth, amen? He died upon a cross. He rose from the dead. He conquered sin and death and hell and the grave. And you're going to talk about your hell and the grave. Why don't you talk about the one who destroyed it, man? You're going to talk about your death? Talk about the one who conquered death. You're going to talk about sorrow? Talk about the one who paid the price for it, man. You're going to talk about your depression? Come on now. Which God do you serve? Does anybody in the house of God, never mind the world, have a God? Does anybody have a God? Yes. Or are you serving these lesser gods that got no mouth, they got no ears, they got no hands, they got no power? No, they don't. Does anybody serve the true and living God? When people are from the outside are looking in, do they say, where is your God? Do they say, where is your God? Based upon our conversation and our miserable prayers and the thought processes that go on in our minds all day, every day. God forbid anyone should ever see my thoughts. I'd be destroyed. Are you agreeing for me? Oh, preacher. I knew it, preacher. I knew it. I had a feeling. Oh, Jesus. See, the truth of the matter is, what's in our mouths is a product of what's in our minds, man. We're so depressed and worn out and tired. How many times a day do you say, I'm tired? Woo, that one hit good. Hey, bullseye. I know it because I say it all the time. That's why I know I got you. I think I wake up in the morning, I'm so tired. What the heck is that? You too, Marilyn?
Yeah.
All right, I didn't even get out of the covers. Jesus, I'm so tired. You too, John? Even the under 40 team, John? Oh, Jesus. Where is our God who conquered death and life? Where is our God? Are the people around you running to your God? Or they think your God is no bigger than their God? Where is our God? Are we God conscious? How do you see yourself? And then how do you see the world around you? Amen. It says here, it says, those who make them, in verse 8, it says, those who make them will become like them. You keep talking about that. That becomes who you are. You will become what you worship. What you spend your time thinking about and talking about is what gives you your identity. You say, I'm being real. Well, you know those words aren't true anymore. Stop thinking about it. Stop talking about it, because you're giving life to that identity in your life. God says, here's your answer. Be God conscious. There's nothing empty about it. There's nothing empty about seeing God in your life, and there's nothing empty about seeing God in everybody around you. There's nothing empty, amen, amen, Sister Cheryl. There's nothing empty about seeing God in the world. There's nothing empty about it. There's the power of heaven and earth in it. What do you see? Are you God conscious? I know on a Sunday you'll give me an amen, but are you God conscious? When you look into life, your life, when you look into the people in your life, when you look into the world, do you say, What does that one guy say? What a wonderful life, what a beautiful world. What's that song? Man, they can sing it. Why don't you sing it a little bit? Huh? You will become what you worship. Amen, Sister Linda. You will become what you worship. What you give your thoughts to, what you give your words to, that's what you will become. How about that? And 2 Corinthians 3:18, as we close, you know our founding verse. Our founding verse, 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says this. It says, but even this day when Moses is read, the veil is on their hearts. What is the veil? It's a picture of our flesh, how we see the world in such a carnal way. It says, if God can remove the veil from our lives, if we will turn, nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord and takes the veil away, when one turns to the Lord and takes the veil away, do you see nothing but corrupt flesh all around you? Do you see nothing but corrupt flesh all around you? Or do you see God? What do you see? I need to answer a question again. When you look into the people around you and the world around you, do you see corruption or do you see God? Somebody.
God.
And if you don't see God, the scripture says, then turn from your corruption and find God. Look for him and find him. What do you think that means? What do you think that means? If you can't find him, look for him. If you can't find him, if you think he ain't there, look into that person's life a little bit harder. Look into the world a little bit deeper. Why don't you gaze a little bit more into this beautiful world? If you think you'll think you can find God, it says, turn from your wicked ways and stop looking upon it and look upon God. He says, if you will turn to the Lord, he will remove the veil. He will remove the veil. He will remove the veil. And now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord, there is liberty. There is liberty. For we all with unveiled faces are beholding the glory of the God as in a mirror, and we are becoming just like him. How is God going to change your identity and cause us to be just like God? It's by you seeing him and looking into his face. It's by you being God conscious. When you look into your life, when you look into the people around you, when you look into the world, my goodness, what do you see? What do you see? What do you see? And if you don't see the Lord, then turn to the Lord and see him. See him in this world. My goodness, this is how we're going to change the world. We've been so many thousand years the other way trying to beat him into submission. My goodness, you didn't stop what you're doing. Why do you think they're going to stop what they're doing, man? You first. Turn, let us turn from our wicked ways. Let me ask the praise and worship team, come on forward. Scripture says, And I'm going to end as we said already. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and turn from their wicked way and turn to the Lord. Stop looking at the wickedness. Stop looking at the brokenness. Somebody see God. Does anybody see God? I pray that God will strike us in a way where we can never think or speak a corrupt word without thinking of the Lord and thinking of his goodness and thinking about his mercy. we want to talk about how close to death and everything you become. How can you talk about how close to death you become when you're alive? Why don't you talk about life? You just lived. You know how close to death I was? All I know is that you're alive. And you want to talk about death. All right, why don't you stand? Praise the Lord Jesus. What we got? Hallelujah. Amen. Doing all the work today, not us. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for your love. And we are reminded, Lord Jesus, we have power to do nothing except believe your word. So I pray by the Spirit of God inside of us, our belief would be towards your word. And I say, Lord, you remove the veil from us. You remove the veil from our eyes, my Lord God. Cause us to see. I ask you, Father, as we leave this house, let us see your goodness. Let us see your love. Let us see your glory. As we look into the faces of those who are all around us, as we look into this world that you created so many years ago, I ask you, Father, let us see your glory. Let us see your beauty, and let us perpetuate the gospel of the kingdom, the words of God within this world. It's in the powerful name of Jesus we pray, and everybody says, amen. Amen. God bless you. Amen.